To start the session. So till the last session, we have discussed about the basics of Spark streaming, what is streaming, the concept behind it, and we have seen some sample programs also in that. How do we read the data from external sources? How do we process them? Okay. And we have seen the mainly these concepts. The main concepts are this windowing concept, and one more concept is some checkpointing. Okay, and how to read the data from a remote server through a socket connection, and how to get read the data from some file systems like HDFS, RAWS, or you know what, local file system also. Okay, we have seen this. Integration, that is not integration exactly, you can say Spark streaming application reading the data from various sources. When mainly these are the apart from this, we have discussed about the basic concepts of Spark streaming. What is Spark streaming, how many cores are required, and how much memory is required, and how do we supply submit the Spark application to a cluster. The stuff we have seen already. Okay, in this session, from this session, I can say from this session, we shall try to see how Spark is going to pull the data from many of the external applications. Go external sources, main external source such as Twitter application, from a Twitter application, and from a streaming application called as Flume. From another application called as Kafka, and one more application called as Kinesis. Okay, you know about our Twitter. No, we shall try to see one by one. Though, how to read the data from Twitter? You know, the Twitter feeds, the tweets. How do we get the tweets? By using the Spark streaming application, and Flume and Kafka and Kinesis. These three are the streaming components. The stream components that are available before this Spark. Okay, so we shall see what is the purpose of this and how do we use them later. We shall try to understand each and every source in detail, and we shall try to see how Spark streaming application can pull the data. And actually it can pull the data, it can receive the data. It will receive the data from all these applications. It receives the data from Twitter, it receives the data from Flume, receives data from Kafka, Kinesis, and processes, and finally store the result into some storage system. You know, this is what generally the purpose of the Spark application, stream or batch application, is to read the data from some source, process it, and finally store the result back to some storage system. That is a general, behavior of any Spark application. Now here, these are the sources we are going to consider for our streaming applications. So like we have seen our earlier sessions in reading from HDFS, reading from local file system, reading from AWS, and reading from Cassandra, that is a NoSQL databases, reading from RDBMS. So we have seen all these applications. Likewise, our interest will be on creating the Spark streaming applications. So why? Because when we take a Twitter application, the tweets will be fed continuously. And Flume, Kafka, even these are the streaming components where they send. That in streaming, in the sense, it has to pull the data continuously. That's very simple. Okay. Now, as the first attempt, let us go. We starts with the Twitter. How do we pull the data from a Twitter in the Twitter feeds? How do we get those Twitter feeds? And what is that we have in the Spark streaming application? Let's try to understand that. Okay. This is the program. This is a program corresponding to that, pulling the data from Twitter. Just observe here. So this is a program, this is a package, and everything. Just start from here. Object Spark Twitter, main method, definition main method. After that, we are creating the Spark configurations. Creating the configuration object, later creating the Spark context, and after that, just ignore this for a while. Next, creation of streaming context, and finally pulling the data from this Twitter by using this is the step that is going to pull the data from Twitter. That is receiving data or tweets from Twitter. Yeah, and this equation, we know everything, and these are the Twitter credentials to access the data. To get the data from Twitter, we need to have an account, that to developer account, not a normal account, user account, developer account we need to have in Twitter, and we get this consumer key, consumer secret. Four keys are required. Okay, these four keys we need to pass, then only we can get the data from the Twitter, otherwise no. Just go through this program. It's a very simple program. There's only this part. This part is very crucial. Reading the data from Twitter and this one. Nothing else. Everything we have seen in our previous sessions, everything. Just any questions on this, just go through program and let me know if you have any questions. I will try to explain. Yeah, is it fine? Hello, any questions? Please, someone respond. Is it okay? Are any questions?
Yeah, Karnakar, it's fine.
Right.
So it is just the configuration, right? Setting.
Yeah. Configurations, just we need to provide the credentials, like we have seen when to pull the data from or to write the data to this, what you call as Amazon S3, there also we need to have our two keys are required there. One is called as access key, another called as secret key. So likewise, we require four keys to pull the data from this Twitter. That's simple. The thing is, just go to this link, apps.twitter.com. okay, not a normal account, or not twitter.com, apps.twitter.com. just go to this, you can see the link here, the URL here, apps.twitter.com. after getting in, if you have an account already in the Twitter, just you can sign in with that. Just you can log in with already Twitter account, if you have any Twitter account. And the thing is, you need to create a new app here. Create new app. It is going to create new app. And in this, you need to provide some name of the app, application you are trying to develop for Twitter. Okay. Let me say a sample. Spark Twitter application. That's a description. You need to give some description. This is an app for testing purpose. And some website. If you are using, if you have an website, you can give any website. So I'm giving this website. Just after that, this is not required, this is not mandatory. This field, check callback URL, just click on the agreement conditions and create a new Twitter application. Yes, it will create a new application, and here you will have keys and access tokens here. Okay, keys and access tokens, just click on this. You will have here consumer key, this is a consumer key, this is the key of consumer key, and consumer secret key, consumer key, consumer secret key. And you need to provide four keys here: consumer key, consumer secret key, access token, and access token secret. Four keys are required. That is, here we have only two: consumer key and consumer secret. We should have access token also. Here you have an access token, your access token. Create my access token. If you click on this, it is going to create the access token, the keys. Just scroll down. Here you have the access token. This is access token key, and this is the action token, access token secret. So totally these four keys are required for pulling the data from the Twitter. Okay. Now, so what we are doing here, it is this is a public feeds. Okay, all these are public tweets. DS, we are pulling the data from the Twitter, in order to read the data of Twitter, first we need to apply this function called as getText. GetText in the sense, get the tweet, whatever the tweet is that is going to be accessed. And after that, I'm looking for the tweets, I'm looking for all the tweets in which Trump, there is a word called Trump, something like Donald Trump. Okay, so I would like to see how many people are tweeting on Trump. Okay, so I would like to filter those tweets. So filter x implies x dot contains Trump, that is a tweet will be given. So in the tweet, if I have a word called as Trump, that this application is going to get only those tweets, not all the tweets. Out of all the tweets, public tweets, all the tweets in which Trump word is there, only these tweets are going to be filtered, and we are going to get them. Okay, now and after that, I'm trying to print them onto the console. Okay, and if we want, we can see how many tweets are getting generated, how many tweets are getting generated on Trump. Okay? We can see that count also. We can, if you want, we can see the count of it. So I am going with count as well as I am going with the printing of the both, so, you know, count as well as number of tweets and what are those tweets. So I'm trying to print all this. Okay, the streaming application, it is reading the data, pulling the tweets continuously from Twitter, and for every 10 seconds, this is a batch interval, for every 10 seconds it is going to get the count of it, and printing the tweets both. Okay, just let us run this. Run Spark Twitter. So in Twitter, we call them as tweets, you know. Every line or what the text the user enters, the user center to user of Twitter enter, we call them as tweets. Okay, why? Because every application has its naming convention. So let's understand the first one, Twitter tweets. Okay, so how do we get the data from the tweets? Is get text is the function that is used to pull the data from that. Something wrong. What is it? Output committer security exception class just servlet configuration. Does not match signer information of other classes in the package. One second, are this my same or not? Just me take this newly generated keys. This is a consumer key. Let me copy this. and replace with this consumer key. Fine. Next, consumer secret. This is a consumer secret.
Karnataka, does that slash T also required?
No, no,
The
not.
tab.
No, no, not required. I'm removing it. That should not be there. Okay, that should not be there. Next one, access key. This is the access token. Access token. And next, access token secret. Yeah, fine. Now let us try to run this application. What's the problem? Successful. So let's send information. Does not match information of other classes. Just 1 second. Just let me close and open the project once. There is some problem with Java. Just wait a second, let us wait for a second. Something operation is going on here. So it is fine. Let us try now once. Yes, it is working now. Then you can see this. Just you can see. Here you see the number of first output is about the number of tweets, and second one is number of what are those tweets, printing of those tweets. Okay, just if you scroll down, for every 10 seconds we are going to get the result for every 10 seconds. So meanwhile some log information will be shown. Yes, you can see here in the second set, 10 seconds, there are six tweets on Trump. And what are those six tweets we are going to see now. These are the tweets you can observe here. You can see here there's a Trump here in the first tweet. I think a second tweet also must be there. You can see Trump here again. Okay, likewise, so in all the tweets, wherever the data is there, wherever Trump is available, so all these tweets are going to be generated. If want, we can move these tweets to some AWS, or if you want, we can move these tweets, all these tweets, to some file system. Wherever we want, we can move the tweets to that location. Yes, you can see in the second 10 seconds, four tweets are generated, those tweets are these. These are the tweets from here to here. From here up to here, I think. One more tweet is there here. So different tweets are there. Like this, we can generate the tweets. And can we move all these tweets to AWS? Is it possible? Is it possible to move all these tweets to AWS? Yeah, that means that is another one, AWS storage S3. Yes, we can do that. Simply, as we have seen in the previous sessions, we should have an account in AWS, and we should have those two keys. With the help of that, we can move the data to AWS. Let us try that also. Can we specify time limit from this period tweets? Time period in the sense, what is that exactly?
Yeah, Kanaka. Means now currently randomly we are picking up all these tweets, right? Like,
yes.
Can we specify, look, okay, from this point of time, any tweets on something, we need to retrieve that like that.
A specific point of time we can't configure here. That depends upon the time when we have started this application. That's it. But we cannot, configure the application to be started at that point of time. That can be done with shell scripting. No, that can't be done in the programming, but it can be done outside the programming. It starts the applications. When the application starts, then automatically it is going to be retrieve the data from Twitter. But we cannot configure in the application to start only from this particular time. That we can't do.
Okay.
That has to be
Through shell scripting means like through in interactive mode we should be able to do that.
No, not interactive mode. Shell scripting, this is not interactive mode. This is the application we have developed, and when to launch this application, let us say every day. Actually this is a streaming application we run continuously 24/7, but generally let's assume that I would like to see what are the tweets generated on this particular, what is that requirement. Let us say every day from morning 5 o'clock to evening 5 o'clock, let's say like that. So we have to start the application in the morning 5 o'clock and end by 5 o'clock. That's what our intention has to be. So that can be done by using a programming again. Not this programming, not this Spark program, there is external programming. That programming is called as shell scripting. We can do that shell scripting.
So Karnakar, it means to say, like, let's say this altogether, this jar file will be kept in some shell script with Spark submit kind of thing.
Yes.
And we'll be just placing this shell script to run with cron tab jobs or else like control m jobs.
Yes, cron tab job.
And we'll be suspending. We'll be suspending at that point, particular point of time, right?
Yes. We start and we stop at a particular point of time that we specify in cron tab job. Okay, cron tab job low. We can specify when to start and when to stop. That can be done from there. Okay. For this, we need to create a jar file and we need to give the path of this and we need to provide the script actually. Spark hyphen submit script will be there, right? That script has to be provided in that what you call as shell scripting. That I will try to show. Okay, next session I will try to show you that how to schedule this application on a daily basis, on a regular basis. Okay, clear? Just let me show you that AWS also, how to write the data to AWS. This is my AWS, AWS credentials. So we need to set these two properties, sc.hadoop configuration, set these two credentials in the application after creation of Spark context. These are my AWS credentials. AWS credentials, okay. After this, now instead of printing, after printing it, if you want, we can save to ds2.save as text files. Save as text files, give the path of it s3a:// This is a bucket name in AWS. I don't remember the bucket name. Just let me log into that AWS also. AWS. Sign into the console. S3 and bucket name is Spark sample bucket. This is the bucket name. Spark sample, sample bucket, and give some name to it for the file that is that has to be created in AWS. For every 10 seconds a new file will be created. Okay, a new file will be created in where what you call as in AWS. Now let us say Trump tweets, let us say like this. Okay, now let us run the application. So now the data has to be printed onto the console. At the same time it has to be written to AWS, this bucket. Let us see what happens. Let us go to this and click the bucket, click on this bucket, and Trump, you have to see Trump tweets. Just refresh this page. You can see here Trump tweets, first file is created here, the first output is created. If you see this, this I think it is going on still. Let me just refresh it. No, data is not yet. I have not yet done here. 1 second. We have to refresh the page continuously. One second. What's happening here? Let us see, is working fine. Something wrong here. That is the reason it got stopped there. What is that? Only one tweet is generated. Why this application got stopped? ds2.cls text files. What is the problem? What is getting stopped automatically? Some error code 50, it is showing error code 50. What is it? Apache Hadoop native IO, native IO Windows.access 0. Removing something wrong in writing the data to this one. Yes. There must be something, some problem with this. Files are getting created, but the data is not getting written into this. Let us try with SDFS at least. SDFS colon double slash the t.161:8020 slash let us try to see write to SDFS. Let us see what is going to work or not. Just let us verify that in SDFS. Loop name node. Just scroll down. We are CUI. Close the file system. And here we should see that trump tweets. You can see here trump tweets are generated here. Let's try to open one. Yes, it is, the data is getting created here. Yes, but some are empty. Almost all are empty. Sorry, they're not writing the data. What's the problem? One second. Tweets. Yes, we have the data in this. These are the empty tweets. No data in that. But wherever the data is there, it is going to create the data into all of them. Yes. Yes, we get the data. Okay. So this is how we can write the data to HDFS. Let me just check out what is the problem issue with that AWS. It is not writing the data to AWS. Something wrong with that. That is HDFS not compatible. It is showing an exception. HDFS compatible to exception. Just let me try to figure it out. Let me try to fix it. I'll try to show in the next session if possible. Okay. Got it? Any questions in this? Just going to stop it. Okay. Right. So this is how we can read the data from Twitter by using any account, and we can write the data in storage systems. We can print out to the console, whatever we want, we can do. So similarly, if you want, you know, you can write to any storage system. It need not be only HDFS, AWS. We can write to RDBMS, we can write to NoSQL database, anything we can write. Okay, that's it. That depends upon our business logic. And what is the operation that we're trying to do here? That too purely depends upon our business logic. But this is the basic, you know, template, reading and writing the data from Twitter. Okay, any questions on this? Fine. Now, so if this Twitter is okay, let me just introduce you to the streaming components like Flume and Kafka. Sorry, 1 second. So the detailed explanation of what is Flume and Kafka components, I have already videos, my videos are there. I will send you the links of those videos, just go through them in order to get the complete picture of what is Flume and what is Kafka. Okay, but in this session, I will try to give overview of what is Flume and what is Kafka. But the detailed explanation and the practicals of this Flume and Kafka only, you know, separately, not with the integration with Spark. Only the components, Flume and Kafka. I have several videos are there. I'll just to send you the links, go through them and try to understand them, how Flume behaves and Kafka behaves in practical, so that you'll understand easily about them. But in this session, let me try to give at least the basic idea of them. Then I will try to show how to get the data from Flume as well as how to get the data from Kafka by using Spark. Okay, so these two are called as, generally we call them as streaming components. We call them as streaming components or streaming tools, we can say that. So what these tools are going to do, what do they do, what is the purpose of them? A Spark application is there, that is, its purpose is to process the data, to pull the data and process it and to export the data, the read, write and store the data. This is the general behavior of any Spark application. Similarly, what is the purpose of, what is the behavior of Flume and Kafka? What do they do and what's their purpose? Let's try to understand about them. First, let us go with the Flume. Okay, so Flume is a component that can be used to pull the data, to receive the data from external source. Like Spark is doing now, Flume also can be used to pull the data, to read the data from some external source and to write the data into some storage system. Hadoop compatible. Okay, these storage systems are Hadoop storage systems. Not all the storage systems. Flume is designed solely for Hadoop. Specially are only mainly for Hadoop. Okay, it is not going to write the data into any other storage systems, mainly the Hadoop compatible storage systems only, not storage systems like AWS, something like that, only Hadoop storage systems. So you can ask me, what would be the Hadoop storage systems? The Hadoop storage systems would be these, you know, it can be HDFS or it can be Hive, it can be HBase. It can be local file system also. You can write the data local file system. So if we have any remote server, if there is any remote server which is having the data, this is called external source, and it is going to pull the data from source and is going to write the data into this storage system. That's it. So it is not going to, the Flume doesn't involve in the processing of the data. Okay, remember that. Just its purpose is to only to pull the data from source and write it into some storage system. So thereafter, it's our responsibility, it's up to us. So how to process the Flume data, by using whether by using Spark, whether by using MapReduce, or you know, you can use any component for processing of this data, that's up to us. But its duty or its only purpose is to pull the data from external source right into target system. That's it, very simple. Okay, so in this, coming to the internal, you know, structure of this Flume. Flume is made up of mainly three components. It is made up of three components mainly. Those components are called as source, channel, and sink. Three components. One is called as source, the second is called as channel, and third is called as sink. Channel and third is called as sink. Okay, then what is source, what is channel, and what is sink? In Flume, we don't write any programs. We don't write any programs. Instead, just we make the configurations. I will show you what is the configuration, how it will be. I will show you. It will just simply read and we need to just set the configurations. No need of writing any Java programs or any programming. No programming is required here. Simply we can do that. It's very easy to use actually. Okay. So source, channel, and sync. So if we want to create, if the Flume application has to read the data from any source and it has to write into any target system, any storage system, we need to configure these three components in our Flume application. So if we configure these three, that in an application, that simply called as the Flume application. That's it. Simply understand that a Flume application should have source, channel, and sync. That's, we need to configure these three. So how to configure them, and what is the purpose, how shall we do them, and what is source, what is channel, and what is sync? Let us try to understand that also now. Coming to first source. Okay, source is a component, or source configuration is about. I will show you in practical. Okay, don't worry, I will show you in practical. Before that, let me give you a brief overview of this components or this source. The information, it should contain the information of, that is, it must be configured, source must be configured with the information of the external source from where, you know, the application is pulling the data, from where the Flume application is trying to pull the data. That information, the information of that source, it may be remote server or it can be anything, the information of that source must be provided in the term called as source here. That is information, I am writing it itself, information of external source. And the sync, this sync contains the information of the target storage system. The target storage system. Okay, information of external source, information of target storage system. And channel, channel contains the information of some intermediate storage. Intermediate storage. Okay, just remember these three terms. Source, channel, and sync. Source contains the information of external source. Sync contains the information of target storage system, that is this one, this target. And this information, the about information of external source with the source, and the information of target system with the sync. And before the data, you know, after pulling the data from external source, and before the data is returned to the target storage system, the data will be, you know, stored in a intermediate storage. Will be stored somewhere. We'll see that word somewhere, and that information will be available with the channel. So totally, only these three components. Very very simple to, you know, configure this Flume application also. It's very simple. Okay, now let me show you a stored information through channel. Yes, stored. Yes, that will be stored as well as moved. I'm telling you, stored as well as moved. So why this intermediate storage is required? Let's try to understand that. So source. Let's understand this is the source from where we are pulling the data. Well, let me something like this. Source to destination, that is the target storage system. Okay, fine. Now the data has to travel in the network, right? The data has to travel in the network. The data has to travel in the network, isn't it? The source and target are connected in network only, right? Now what if happen, you know, this application, so where the Flume application has to run here now? This is a source server, let us say the server, and this is a target. It can be a single node or it can be a cluster. or it can be a cluster. It can be generally it would be a single server, a single node. It is a single node or cluster. If it is SDFS, it will be a cluster. If it is not SDFS, local file system, it will be a single node. That's what I'm trying to say here. Now, so data has to travel completely, you know, in one go. It has to start from source. It has to reach the target. Okay, what, you know, the first question is, where shall we run the Flume application now? Whether on the remote server there is a source, or in you know what called as the target, where we have to run the Flume application. The first question is, where to run the Flume application? Where to run Flume app to pull the data from source and write into target? Where? So already I made a point in the previous sessions that for any, you know, if we have any cluster here, you know, real-time cluster, production cluster, so we don't go to the cluster, but we interact with the cluster. That is, we read the data from the cluster, or we write the data to a cluster, or we deploy the applications through a node called as edge node. I made a point, this point here, edge node, a client. I think I made this point in the previous sessions. Okay, edge node or client, are this also called as gateway node. Gateway node. So everything, you know, entering the data into this cluster, there's nothing but a cluster, storage cluster, and reading the data from it, pulling the data from it to the external system. That is the external world, and this is the cluster. And this is going to be done, all these read and write operations from this cluster, you know, by having a node, you know, as an interface between these two worlds, that we generally call as a gateway node or an edge node or a client. So we run the, generally we run the application, Flume application here. We launch the application here, Flume application. Okay, got it? So here, between the external server, this external server, and this is the target. This is our target now. So in this external server and the target, so this is a network, right? This is a network. The data has to travel the network from here to here, and this is also a network. Okay, now, so data has to start from here, the server. It has to reach this cluster. Meanwhile, suppose, let's say, if this network is down, let's assume like that. If this network is down, then whatever the data that Flume application is pulling from source, where it has to be reposted, or shall we stop the pulling also? You know, pushing the data into this production cluster, the cluster, the network is down. Then in that case, how the Flume application has to behave? What it has to do? What it has to do? Okay, just let me tell you here. So as just now I told, Flume application is made up of three components: source, channel, and sink. Okay, now in this, this would be external world source. This contains information of this, and sink is about the cluster. Then what is the channel here? So this component of Flume should contain information of intermediate storage. Suppose if this network fails, so in that case the data cannot be delivered to the cluster. That is the target system. The data cannot be delivered to the target system. In that case, what has to be done? What Flume application has to do? Whether it has to stop receiving the data from the server, or shall it continue? Which one you recommend? Yeah, continue, right? So it must be continued, you know, unless there we come up with a serious issue. It must be continued. The network's down and server down, that will be there. Why? Because the cluster may be down sometime, the servers may be down sometimes. You don't say every time, sometimes, very, very rare it, under some situations. In that case, the data cannot be delivered. The data cannot be delivered to what you call as this target system. Okay, so in that case, the data has to be, the receiving will be continued. Receiving will be continued and the data will be staged. I say that data will be staged in some storage system. In some storage system. So in this we are taking this client. So this channel will contain the information of the client. That is nothing in client. In a machine, in a node, what will be used for storage of data? Either we can use memory or we can use disk. Isn't it? We can use memory or we can use disk. So the data can be reposited, that is preserved, staged in either in memory or in the disk. That we can configure it. That we can configure. So the data will be pulled from the server and the data gets staged and that will be preserved in this client node. And once this network resumes, automatically the Flume is going to write the data into this sink. It will be done automatically. We not do anything. So in case of any failure of the network between channel and sync, there's nothing but channel. This is going to as a channel now. Channel and sync. So automatically the data will be, accumulated. You can say that accumulated are staged with the client. So client will contain information of where the data has to be preserved. So it is going to be stored in the intermediate storage system. Here we have taken one node. So as we have taken only one node for intermediate storage, either we can use memory or we can use disk for storage of data. That's intermediate storage of data. So why we are using intermediate storage of data is to handle the faults, that is you to handle the failures, to handle the network failures. So once the network is down, the data cannot be delivered. So in that case, how that failure has to be handled? So if we have some intermediate storage, it can be handled for some time. I don't say it will be too long. It can handle the fault, that failure, for a certain period of time. Then after that, it can be resumed and the data can be delivered to the target system. So that is the intention of having a channel. Why do we need to have a channel? Is in order to handle the failures. If you don't have the channel, failures cannot be handled. Just can you tell me, if you do not have the concept of channel, what would be the consequences if the network is down between source and what we call as this production cluster or the target? What would be the consequences? If you don't have channel, do you think channel is compulsory? Or if you don't think it is not compulsory or mandatory, then how does Flume application has to behave under failures? Yes, can anyone try? Just make a guess. Yes, it won't receive the data. That's fine. That will be there. But let's assume to pull the data without any receiver, sorry, without any channel. Let's say there is only source and that is source and this is called as what you call as sync, right? Just called as sync. So let's assume it takes 1 minute to travel the data to travel in the network to reach the target system, that is the sync, the target storage system. What if the network fails? I said that there is some records are there here. So for a record to reach the target system, it will take 1 minute over the network. Let's assume like that. Now, what if after 30 seconds or before 1 minute, if the network goes down, then where this data has to go? Whatever the data that was delivered by the source, but that was not yet received by the sync, but where it has to go now? Where the data has to go? Yes, any questions? Yeah, Vakaresh, sir, not any questions. Any answers I'm asking? Any guesses about this? Where this data has to go if this network is down before 1 minute? If it takes 1 minute,
it has to store in channel.
Yeah, and I'm asking if there is no channel. So we are using channel for the purpose. If we don't have channel, what should happen?
It has to run from the beginning.
Yes. Okay. Generally, generally ignore this flow for now. See this now. We have two machines, let's say. We have two machines in a network, and we're trying to move the data from copy or move the data from one node to another node in a network. Suppose the network is down. What will happen to the data that was already sent by the source? What will happen to it? Let's not discuss about with respect to Flume now. In general cases, in general network, if the data is already sent by the server, the resource, but suddenly the network is down, so the data cannot be received here, that's for sure. Then what should happen to the data that was already sent? What will happen in case of a network? Yeah. So there will be in a network, there will be two types of transfers generally, remember. Two types of network communications. Network data transfers. So we use many protocols, right? SSH protocol, TCP protocol, UDP, all the preferred protocols. Two types of network transfers will be there. One is called as synchronous transfer. Synchronous, and there is called as asynchronous. Synchronous and asynchronous. Synchronous is nothing but the target, source and sync. That is a target. So after the target receives some data from the source, it is going to send acknowledgement. Okay, so target has will give an acknowledgement that yes, this is the data. What is this is the data that all I received. So if the target, if the source, you know, who is going to send the acknowledgement here? The source is going to send the data, and acknowledgement will be sent by the target to the source. So what is that acknowledgement? This is the data that I have received from you. These are the number of bytes. This is the identity. You know, there's a different network, total network concept here. But just I'm trying to brief this. So the target has to send an acknowledgement. So acknowledgement says that yes, that's whatever the data that was sent by the source, that is delivered successfully. Let's assume that the source has sent 10 records or 100 records, let us say. 100 records to the target, but the source has received you know, the acknowledgement for only 90 records, only for 90 records. The source will understand that only 90 records are delivered, so the remaining 10 records are not yet delivered, so it will try to resend those records to the target system. So how it is able to do that is the target has to send the acknowledgement to the source. This type of data transfer will be called as synchronous data transfer. Okay, and asynchronous. What is asynchronous is no acknowledgement will be there. No acknowledgement. Okay, got it? No acknowledgement will be there. So whatever the data that is being sent by the source, it is no acknowledgement will be there, and source does not bother about whether the target is working active or inactive. It will be simply pushing that, you know, it will simply pushing the data into this target system. That is called as async. This is the general behavior of any network transfer. Okay, so but we cannot make, you know, we cannot make the data to be, you know lost in between source and sync. Before reaching the target, the data should not be lost. That is the reason. And at the same time, you know, we can make the application to have here also acknowledgement will be sent from the channel, actually from the channel to the sync in this case. But if you do not have a channel, there is no problem. We can get the data back again by going synchronous transfer. But what the problem is, it is going to waste the time. You know, it is going to waste the time. The time is going to be, let us say that the network is down for 1 minute or some 10 minutes, let us say 10 minutes. So if the channel could account, you know, could handle this 10 minutes of data, then the flow will be continued, right? You know, the entire application need not to be stopped. The flow will be continued, but only this data cannot be delivered to the sync. If the channel could not handle this 10 minutes of data, obviously what is going to happen? The entire application will be down That is, the application will halt, and again we need to resume the application. We need to restart the application to pull the data from it. Okay, this is going to delay. It is going to create too many negative impacts. So that is the reason we compulsory we have a channel. That is the reason Flume has recommended to have a channel compulsory in between source and the target systems. Got it? Any questions on this?
Kanak, I believe in the channel will be having some buffer kind of thing, right?
Yes, yes.
Buffer interval something.
Yes.
I have seen it long back.
Yes, yes, yes. It will be there. I will show you now. Okay. No. So source. This is important. Whatever the point I'm trying to give you now, this is very important. Try to understand. Source and target. Source and destination. Let me call it as target. It is the source. About the channel. What about the target? Whether it would be a cluster or single node? Is a cluster or single node? It can be a single node, or it can be a cluster. Yes, it supports both. Then what about the channel? What about the channel? Can it be a cluster, or it has to be a single node? Yes, Flume can have here also single node or a cluster. Okay, so the only cluster that can act as cluster, I'm telling you, cluster. Okay, cluster in the sense multiple nodes. Okay, the only cluster that can act as a channel for Flume application is Kafka cluster. We'll discuss that, what is a Kafka cluster. Okay, it is a cluster actually. Okay, like HDFS cluster, Kafka also is a cluster, runs on a cluster. So the only cluster that can be a channel for Flume applications is the Kafka, and for remaining other applications, remaining all the channels are, they will be single node channels. So if you have a single node, obviously what would be the storage system single node? Either it can be a memory or it can be a disk. It can be a memory or it can be disk generally, right? Memory and disk. So this is what I'm trying to show here. Okay, I will try to show you what are the different sources. I will send you documentation also about this. So what are the different sources from which Flume application can read the data from, pull the data from, and what can be the different channels that Flume supports, and what are the different target systems to which this Flume can write the data to. So they have a list of them already. We have a list of sources, list of channels, and a list of sinks here. So three are there. So a sink can be a single node or a cluster. A channel can also be a single node or cluster. What about source? Yes, source can also be a single node or it can be a cluster. Remember this. Single node or it can be a cluster. Just remember these points. Okay. So a Flume application can be designed to pull the data from a single node or a cluster. A channel can also be a single node or cluster, and the target can also be a single node or cluster. Just remember these parts. Okay, it is important. Now, what are those different sources, and what are the different channels, and what are the different things? I will try to show you the list of all of them. Okay, I will send you the documentation. Just I will try to show you all the list. You will understand what is that sources, channels, and sinks. What is the basic behavior of source, channels, and sync? Okay, so source, channel, and sync. Next, there are three different sources, let us say. That means there are three different external sources in which we have the data. Now, can we design a Spark as a Flume application to pull the data from multiple sources, multiple servers? Is it possible? Can a Spark application can read the data from multiple applications, that is multiple sources? Can we design a Spark application to pull the data from multiple sources or not? Yes? Can we do it or not?
Yes.
Yes. It can pull the data from multiple sources. Even Flume can be designed to pull the data from multiple sources. So this is external server 1. Let's assume like that. Server 2 and server 3. So we can have a Flume application to have three sources. Source 1, source 2, and source 3. So in case of Spark, I'm telling you, if the Spark application is designed to read the data, to pull the data from, let's assume, three sources here, external sources, then what we need to design in a Spark application to pull the data from external sources, we call them as what? Here we are calling them as what? Sources. But in Spark we call them as what? We call them as receivers. Okay, in Spark we call them as receivers. In Flume we call them as what? Sources. Okay, got the point here? Now, after writing the data into multiple sources, three different sources, and how many sources we can have here? So if Flume supports pulling the data from multiple external sources, then how many sources a Flume application can have? Multiple, right? It can be one or two or three, any number of, that depends upon. So multiple sources. Okay, next, coming to the channels. How many channels we can have? How many channels we can have? How many? One or two or three or four? Multiple? Okay, multiple, but how many? Does it depend upon the number of sources? Yeah, any guesses here? Okay, so the number of channels can be multiple or one or more. It can be one or more. In one or more, but it can be less than the number of sources, greater than the number of sources, or equal to the number of sources. That's up to us. Okay, that's up to us. So number of sources are defined by the number of external servers or external sources, and number of channels we have to configure. Okay, there is no particular mandatory thing to have the number of channels in any application, that we have to design the number of channels. It's purely our interest. Okay, the number of channels can be one or more, but how many? So that does not depend on the number of sources here. Okay, it is totally independent. So the number of channels does not depend on the number of sources. Remember that point. Okay, but how many channels are to be there? How do we understand it? Now see that three sources, that means three kinds of data we are going to get, isn't it? We get three kinds of data, but how do you want to process this data? Whether you want to combine these three sources of data or you want to process them separately? You want to process them separately or you want to combine them? The data that is being received from three sources. What shall we do? Let's assume that if we're trying to combine these three data, you know, I want to process the data from these three sources as a single unit. Okay, I would like to combine all the data from coming from them. So in that case, I would like to go with one channel. So there the data will be combined. All the data coming from three sources can be combined. Got it? You got my point right here? This is only one channel I'm going to take here. But instead of that, I do not want to go with only one channel. I would like to process the data of the sources separately. Then you can choose a source to write into another channel and the source to write into another channel. And if you want, a source can write into two channels also, the two channels. Okay, so simply I can say that here, 1 second, that is, if we have a source if we have a source, there can be more than the number of sources. The number of channels can be more than number of sources. That is, a source can write the data into two channels, or two sources can write the data into a single channel. Not exactly two, it can be three also. That is multiple, or they can write into like this. They can write like this. Okay, so a single source into multiple channels possible, as well as multiple channels into multiple channels, multiple sources from multiple channels, or multiple source into only single channel, even that is possible. Got my point right here? So source and channels, the nothing depend, no, these two are not interrelated. The only thing is, this is what the source can write into multiple channels, or multiple sources can write into a single channel. That purely depends upon our business logic or our requirements. So whether to have only one channel or two channels, something like that. Okay, now I'm asking question here. Let's see, this is very important here. In between source, so among this source, channel and sync, which one do you think critical, you know, stage, critical one, source, channel or sync, which will play an important role here? Source, channel or sync? Channel, right? Obviously channel. Suppose if the channel is down, if the channel is down, if the entire channel is down, that is the network or the system is down, then what should happen? What will happen if the channel crashes? What is going to happen? So in case of any network failure, the entire data gets accumulated with the channel. If the channel itself is down, then what is going to happen? Then what is going to happen? Obviously, that data is going to be lost, right? That data is going to be lost, obviously. So it is very, very important. The channel is going to play an important role. So instead of concentrating on source and sync, we must concentrate on the design of the channel perfectly. If you have the channel is working properly, any failure can be handled easily. At the same time, there is no chance of data loss. If the channel is weak, it is not configured properly, then obviously we are going to lose the data. That's for sure. So that is the reason generally when we have a source and sync. Instead of having one channel, generally we have two channels. Okay. And only one sync are, no, let's put this. So why we are going two channels is for replication. The same data is being written into the first channel and same data is being written into the second channel, that is second node. So if this channel is crashed, we can have the data in the as a backup in the second channel. So we can get the data from the second channel. So source is writing in two channels. So in under this scenario, that is where we cannot trust the channel, where we cannot trust the channel, one channel, then we can have alternatively another channel to have the data as a backup. Okay, got it now? No. So what is the relation or mapping between number of sources and number of channels would be? It can be either 1 to n or n to 1 or n to n. It can be 1 to 2, 1 to 3 or 3 to 4. It can be anything. So I can say that it can be 1 to n or n to 1 or end to end, the number of sources and channels. But what has to be done? Mapping between channel and sinks. Now we have to make a guess, think logically and try to understand. Try to tell me what has to be the mapping. That is the number of channels is going to impact, show any impact on the number of what we call as sinks or not? Are they independent or the dependent? Number of channels and number of sinks. Yeah. Does the number of channels has to do anything with the number of sinks or not? Are they are different? So here the number of sources and channels, they are different, right? They can be, there can be any number of sources and number of channels. And channels, coming to channels and sinks, is there anything that will come into picture about the number of channels and sinks, are they independent again? Yes, Hima, Venkatesh, any guesses from your side?
Can you please come again with the question?
You know, if we have two channels, right? How many things can be there? Two or more than, or less than two, or only one?
But I believe like any sync can accept the data from only one channel.
Yes, that's true.
So one channel output can be provided to multiple syncs. So that is 1:n.
No, this can't be done here. Remember, channels are designed by the Flume in such a way that they can deliver the data to only one sync. They can deliver data to only one sync, exactly one sync. So the number of channels must be always equal to the number of syncs. Remember that point. Sync 1 or sync 2. The number of channels must be always equal to number of syncs. It can be like this, or it can be, you know, we can delete it, and we can have something like this again. We can have like this. But always, a sync must be mapped with only one channel. But it is not the case with source and channel, but this must be the case with always the connection has to be one to one between channel and syncs. Okay, remember this one. This is important here. So the mapping between source and channel can be this, and the mapping between channels and syncs has to be always one to one mapping. One channel per one sync. Number of channels equal to number of syncs. This must be the criteria that must be followed in setting the Flume configuration. Got it? So sources, channels, and syncs. This is what we have to understand about this. Okay. Now let me show you a simple, practical example of how to design a Flume, how to configure a Flume application, and how to run the Flume application. What is channel made up of? I told you already. Channel can be a single source, or channel can be a cluster. I told you that. It can be. Let's assume that if it is a single node. Yes, nodes, cluster in the sense set of nodes, nodes only. Okay, if this is a node, even the syncs in the sense sync can be a cluster, sync 2 can be a cluster or single node, even these can be nodes. Nodes are, they can be nodes or they can be clusters. Okay, got it? Just I will send you the video of a Flume. Two, three videos are there. Just go through them and understand very clearly about all this. Okay. Meanwhile, let me just show you a simple application. Just my VMware. I think I did not show this till now. I think somewhere we have this Flume application. So just let me show you the Flume application. One second. These are all the configuration files, the different various configuration files. I have configured them already. Let me show a simple source, simple application. Flume 1 or Flume 2. Just see this application here. See the configuration of a Flume application. Just observe here. This is called as creation of components. This is what we have seen, that three components: source, channel, and sync. So I'm just writing about the source, channel, and sync here. Creation of components. This is configuring the source. is about the source. Next, this is configuring the channel, and this is configuring the sync. Okay, creation of components, the three components: sources, channels, and sinks. The source, channel, and sync. Just try to understand here. Source, one source we are creating, that name of the source we are giving as S2. This is the name of the channel, and this is the name of the sync. Okay, so any application, okay, remember, any Flume application is uniquely identified by an agent name. So choose any one agent. So any Flume application, any agent name, in the sense, any string, okay, it can take any string, don't worry about it, any string, thus we call it as an agent, that's it. Okay, so entire Flume application will be recognized, will be uniquely identified by an agent, and it can be any string, it can be simply a string, okay, it can take any string there. Second last line, second one from the last, is it? I will let you explain one by one. Wait a second. Okay, so this is Flume is enough. Source is designed in such a way that here, source, what is the source of, you know, this is contain, this source will contain information of the external source, okay, external server, instead that from where we are trying to pull the data. So this is through a socket connection that we have seen in that you know what, in the Spark application, likewise, socket connection, through socket connection from a remote server. Okay, this information. So the protocol used is Netcat protocol, and actually we don't have any other node. That's the reason I'm taking the local of the same node itself, and the port number to be some number. Okay, and next after that, this is what. This is the statement, you know, source configured with channel. Okay, the source name is S2 here. The type of source is Netcat, and it is binding to localhost. The port number is 7777. And to which channel the source has to write the data to? To which channel? That is C2. The name of that channel we are giving it as C2. Next. Configuring the channel. What is the channel? Channel here we are taking, we are running this application on a single node, and the channel name is channel. We are using memory. You know, the memory in that machine we are using as the staging area for the channel. Got it now? So in that case, channel 2, you can see this channel C2.type is equal to memory, and a capacity 500 and transient capacity 100. What is the meaning of the 500 and the 100? Any idea about this? That is how many events or how many records. So source will be sending the data to the channel, channel. So in that case, if there is any network failure between the channel and sync, how many records must be accumulated maximum? Maximum how many records must be accumulated with the channel? That is, we give this value can be configured. So I give the value as some from 500. So if there is any problem with the sync, you know, if the data cannot be delivered to sync, in that case, the data will be accumulated with the channel. And total, how many, what is the capacity you give for the channel is 500 events, that is 500 records. It can accumulate up to 500 records. Thereafter, it is not going to read any, accumulate any data. The source is going to stop here, then after that. Okay, so even though sync is not working for a while, the source will work. The source will pull the data and write the data to the channel up to what? 500 events. If it is filled with 500 events totally, then even the source also will stop reading the data from the external source and push the data into the channel. It is going to stop. Okay, and after that, transaction capacity. So for every 100 events, the transaction will be made. For every 100 events, a transaction will be made. That is, the data will be written into the sync for every 100 transactions. Next, coming to the sync type here. So what is the target system where you are trying to write the data into? The final target system, that is HDFS. We are saying that HDFS, SN2.type is equal to HDFS. And HDFS dot path, that is, in HDFS, what is the path we are trying to load the data? I think this must be a complete path. Localhost colon 8020 slash flume1. So whatever the data that is being received, from the channel, that data has to be stored into HDFS. The type is HDFS and the path. Okay. And what about this one? This is the channel from which sync has to pull the data from. So we make this configuration here. Agent2.syncs.sn.channel equal to C2. Okay. Any questions in this, please let me know. If you have any questions, please let me know in this. Yes. Sorry. Yes. Yes, Hema, Hina, Rajesh, Venkatesh. Any questions in this? The simple, very, very simple and basic Flume configuration application. So what is the source here? It is some remote server transaction capacity. That's what I'm telling you. 500, it is the maximum capacity. Okay, maximum capacity is the 500 events or 500 records. Now, so it has 500 records. Let me explain that. So this application is pulling the data from a remote server, from some remote server. So for that we should have some host name. What is required? Host name and port number are required to make a socket connection. So from remote server, and we are using some node here as a channel. In this we are using memory as a preserving and moving to HDFS. This what? So a source coming to the Flume application. Source will contain information of what? This remote server. So it will contain the host name and port number and the type of connection. How it is pulling the data from the, how it is making connection to remote server through socket connection, that is called as protocol netcat. This information we have with the source. The same information we have with the source. Let me show you that. Okay, see this now. This is the information. Host. So we don't have any other external host, we are going the local host only. Local host netcat and 77 and 77. Is it clear? Right. Next. Next. It is writing. The source has to write the data into this channel. So we give some name to this channel as some S2, C2 and SN2. You can give any some name. Okay, the naming convention. So now it has to write into channel. What is the channel here? The local system, the node, the same node we are using here, but in this we are using memory. We are using memory for the buffering data staging. And so in case of and sync case, we are going to take into HDFS. Again, HDFS, where HDFS is installed, what is the cluster? So in HDFS, it is a cluster, right? So we have to give some path in HDFS. So we have to give some path. That path we gave here. This is the path. In HDFS, under root directory, flume1. This is the place where the data is going to be stored. Okay. The type of is the HDFS. Next. Let me explain this. So in case of failure of this network, what is going to happen? Whatever the data that is being received from the source, it is going to be accumulated in the memory. Okay, so how it is Flume reads the data from external source? Remember, Flume reads the data from external source in the form of events. nothing but every record, right? It is going to read one by one, record by record. It is going to read card by record. So every record will be, you know, called as an event. Okay, in Flume terminology, every card will be called as an event. So how many such events can be accommodated in case of this network loss or network failure? How many can be staged? So that capacity we can give by using capacity as 500 we give. Okay, and transaction capacity. So what my transaction capacity? So after 500 records are already available in this memory, now once this is resumed, you know, once this application is resumed, that is the network, sorry, network is resumed, then the data has to be returned to HDFS, right? The data has to be returned to HDFS. In that case, how it is going to write the data? You know, already 500 are accumulated here. Got it? No, already 500 accumulated, but now the network is up again. Then this 500 events must be returned to HDFS, isn't it? So in that case, how it is going to write 500 events? At a time or record by record or as a bunch? Okay, so as a bunch of 100 records or 100 events at a time. Okay, that is called a transaction capacity. So in 5 attempts, totally if the network is down, so 500 events will be accumulated here. And totally in 5 attempts, it will write all the data that was accumulated in this memory into this HDFS. That is called a transaction capacity. So 100 events, totally 500 events. So in totally 5 attempts, it is going to write the entire data into that got accumulated here into the HDFS. Is it clear now, Hema? Yes, okay. So it is going to make the transaction capacity, that is about capacity, that is about transaction capacity. So transaction capacity and number of transaction capacity, that depends upon here. 500, suppose if 1500 is the capacity, and if the transaction capacity is only some, let us say some 300. So once the network is resumed, in how many attempts the entire 1500 records are going to return to HDFS? So it is going to take totally 5 attempts. So 3 5 is 15. After in 3 attempts, first in the first attempt it will write 300 records. The second attempt it will write the next 300, so total making a total of 600. The third attempt, the next 300, it will make 900 to 1200 and finally 1500, like that. Yeah, that will be written as a stream. That will be written continuously as a stream. I will show you that. I will show you that now. You will understand. Okay, they will continue the stream. I will show you. So under normal functioning, how it will behave? Let me show you that. If I run this application, we understand. Okay, we'll understand from it. Now let us try to run it. So what we have to do for this is, this is the, which is the application, Flume Agent 2. Copy this.
Karnakar, here the channel, now we are writing in Hadoop cluster, right?
Yes, HDFS cluster, yes.
Channel and sync also in Hadoop.
Hadoop only. No. Channel is not in Hadoop. Channel is not in Hadoop. What is the channel here?
But
it is not in Hadoop.
Memory. So memory is just like RAM.
RAM. That is not HDFS. So, that is not Hadoop HDFS. It is a local system, local file system.
Okay.
It is not HDFS, local file system. Okay. We cannot use HDFS as a channel. HDFS cannot be a channel. Okay, but you know, actually that will happen, you know, multiple nodes actually. But actually, you know, we don't have multiple nodes. That is the reason we are doing everything in only one system. Actually, this will be, source will be a different node somewhere. Okay, and this will be the node in which we are running this application now. And this will be some other node, other cluster. But everything is running, we have only in one machine, we are writing everything in localhost. So instead of localhost, what we'll have here, in case of it is a remote host, we'll have the host name of that server, that remote server. And here in case of this localhost, we'll have the host name of the server in which name node is running. Okay, and this memory is going to be the node in which this Spark Flume application is running. there's no going to be by default the application. There's a local file system. It can be HDFS or it can be, so not can be, sorry, it can be Windows or it can be a Linux environment. Any environment can be there. Here we are using Linux environment. What is the Linux OS that is used in this VMware image? The Linux operating system that is used here.
Here it is CentOS.
Yes, CentOS. Okay. So CentOS file system, that is extendable file system. That file system memory will be used for staging, that is a channel, and HDFS will be used for sync. Got it? Still any questions in this? Just okay. Let me go with this. Just copy this. Copy this file. And somewhere in any location, just create one folder. Flume configuration. Configurations. Flume configurations. And in the directory, paste this file. And remember, the file extension has to be .cynf. Rename it to .conf configuration file. So conf flume agent 2.conf. Okay, let me close this and let me open this. This is a configuration file. Okay, now let us try to run this. So how shall we run this is, just go to the terminal. Here the script used for running the Flume application is flume-ng. Flume-ng. Okay. And agent followed by agent name. What is the agent name we have used in this application? The agent name is agent2. It can be any string. We can use any string. So agent2. So use that. Agent 2 and configuration directory. So to where Flume or Spark or Hadoop, everything is installed in Cloudera. What is the path of it? What is the location of it? It is under user lib flume hyphen ng dot. Let me show you that. So in Hadoop, in the Cloudera, this is a path where everything is installed. CD user lib ls. If you see here, you know all the components. You can see all the components here. Flume, Hadoop, Spark, Pig, Scoop, Zookeeper. Everything, all the components will be installed in this location. And let us, you can see Flume here. Flume hyphen ng. So CD. Flume-ng ls, and this is a configuration directory. We'll have all the Flume configurations, Flume library configurations. So, and where do we have the run script, execution script? We are using, what is the script name here? Flume-ng. Okay, the script will be available in which directory? Bin directories. Okay, let us get into that. Let me show you that also. Ls, you can see here flume-ng. This is the script for launching a Spark Flume application. Okay, let me come out of it. Now we are under flume-ng, and these are the directories. This configuration directory cdnf, cynf, it is going to have the all the flume properties files. Okay, flume properties files. So we have to provide the path of that. For that, I'm using here user lib. Flume ng conf. After this, we need to provide the file, the configuration file just now we have created. The path of the configuration file just now we have created. So how do we, what is the path of it? It is in the desktop. It is there in the desktop. This file is in the desktop. It is not untitled folder. Some folder is there. Right. Let me copy this. It's the path of it. Need not to provide this file here. Just simply pass configuration file. This is the path of it. Okay. And after this, -d flume dot root. This is for displaying the log information. The log information after launching the application to launch the to get the log information onto the console. Root lot logger equal to debug, comma. So we are trying to have debug information, debug log information onto the console. This is optional. This is purely optional. Dflume root dot log is optional. It is not mandatory, but remaining stuff is mandatory. So name agent two, configurations and configuration file. Only three parameters. This is the script name here, and this is the agent, followed by agent name, and configuration. And after that, configuration file. That's it. This is optional. Purely this is optional. We can skip this. We can include this. If there are any errors in the application, then it will try to throw the errors. We'll see them here. But if not throwing any errors, we can understand that successfully running here. Okay. Now, how to supply the input and how do we get the output? So where we have to get the output now here? We have to get the output into HDFS. That means the result, the data to be written into HDFS under a directory called as flume1. Okay. Let us try to see what is going to be done here. Flume1. Now we have to provide the data from the remote server, but we don't have remote server. We can provide directly from the local system itself. Let us go to first HDFS. Let us verify it first. Sorry, this is the root directory. And what is the file name we gave here? Flume1. Flume1. Okay. So do you have anything file or folder here? File or folder under name Flume1 here? No, nothing is there like this here. Okay. So let us try to provide the input in this. That is netcat localhost 7777. This is what we have right here. You can see here netcat localhost 7777. And let me enter this. Enter some. Sorry, it is not netcat here. Sorry, NC. NC. So I am entering some random data here. This will be used for easy understanding. That's why I'm using this netcat. The many other sources are there. Now, what should happen now? Whatever data that I have entered now, this data has to move to HDFS. And under directory, under which directory? Flume1. Okay. Let us go to that HDFS and let's just refresh this page now. Now we have to see Flume1 here. You can see Flume1 now it is created. Open this. Okay, you can see some files here. There's some data in this. Are we able to read this data? No, right? We are not able to read this data. And how come it is writing only 367 bytes or 207 bytes or 355 bytes? How it is writing this? Zahin asked here. Okay. In case of normal flow, in case of there is no failure, let us say, if there is normal flow, you know how the data will be written, how many records will be written into this HDFS, isn't it? That is the question you have asked, right? So in this case, and first question before going to that, let me just explain you here why the data is written into this format. What is the format of file? This is, you can see here, SEQ. What is the meaning of it? It's a sequence file format. SEQ stands for sequence file format. If you want to write the data as it is, if you want to write the data as it is into it, then we can use what is run for a telephone log. One second. Let me close this. No. I do one thing here. Agent 2 dot syncs dot sn2 dot hdfs dot file type equal to data stream. I think it is data stream or something else. Just let me check. Flume files. It is data stream only, I think. So simply write data stream here and save this file. Data stream. Now let us see what is going to happen, how the data will be written into that. Now I'm entering the data again. Okay, now let us go to HDFS and verify. Let me refresh this page. We'll get some more events now. You know, how did we get the data now? As it is, right? You know, previously the data was retrieved in a sequence format. Sequence format. Now the data is written as it is. If you see this data, this is about still. And but in the from this file onwards, we got the data in the regular format, this text to file format. So that can be done by using this configuration. That is, data stream by default it will write in sequence file format. If you want to write in a plain format, we can use simply data stream file type, one more configuration. Okay, now coming to this, why the file size here 367 byte? Why 355 bytes, 77 bytes, 43 bytes? Why? And so is there a smooth, you know, smooth execution of the Flume application here? Everything is fine. Everything is running fine. In this case, how many transactions will be, sorry, how many events will be written? So that depends upon three parameters actually. That depends upon three parameters. Let me show you those parameters. Can you see something called here? These three parameters, this three here. Role size, role count, role interval. Role size, role count, and role interval. Okay, these are three properties that are going to decide how to write the data into HDFS under normal flow. Okay, role size, role count, and role interval. Let me explain you what are these. Role size, role count, and role interval. Okay, see this now. So the data is being written into HDFS. That's fine. Okay, now. Okay, so how frequent, no, and that will be written into a file. Obviously, that data has to be written in the form of a file. So how many, into how many files you would like to write the data in HDFS? Just this is streaming. We are getting streaming data, isn't it? We're getting streaming data. So with respect to streaming data, into how many files you would like to write the data into HDFS? Only one file or multiple files? How many files? Yeah, please try to answer. How many files we shall have? How many files we shall have to write the data into HDFS? Shall we allow only one file or multiple files? If multiple files, how many? How many? Why multiple files? Why not only one file? Why not only one file? It's continuous, it's a continuous stream. See here now. Generally, we perform these types of operations on files, right? On file, we perform read operation, write operation. And if you want to perform read operation or write operation, the file must be opened first. Okay? And if you want to perform write operation, it must be read and write operation, it must be opened. If you want to open a file, first it must be closed. Remember that. I think you must have experienced this in the file programming in C or C++ or Java anywhere. If you want to read the data from any file, first the file must be opened, and after the file reading is completed, the file must be closed. Okay, that is the thing. Okay, so let's assume that we are trying to create only one file. Let's say the data is coming continuously from the external source, is writing into only one file, only one file. And so to write the data into this file, the file must be opened, isn't it? The file must be opened. And when this file has to be closed? When this file has to be closed? Yeah, Hima, you have to tell me here. How many, when this file has to be closed now? We're trying to have only one file for the data that is coming from external sources. When this the file has to be closed? Yeah, Venkatesh Chapandi, how many, when this file has to be closed? But you know, after the data is completed. But do you think streaming data is going to complete? When it is going to, it is a continuous application, right? Continuous writing of data into this file. Do you think is it going to complete? And when we say that it is not going to complete? So when the when we close the application, is going to complete. But shall we wait for the computation? Shall we wait for the computation till the spar, you know, application writes the entire data into this? But what is our mode of any Spark, you know, streaming processing of live data? The data we will be receiving at the same time the processing has to go, isn't it? Receiving and processing, they must go in parallel, not one by one. So this won't stop, you know, only after receiving the entire data. How do you say entire data? Well, because it's a streaming application, stream data. Stream data cannot be ended. It cannot be ended, right? It will be generated continuously. So we cannot make the data to be ended after some time. We cannot make it this. You cannot say exactly when it is going to end. So till that point, if the stream data is not going to end, then the file will be open always. So if the file is open, we cannot process the data. It must be closed. If it is closed, then only we can perform the operations on the data. Got my point here now? So in order to process the data of a file, if you want to process the data from a file, the file must be closed. Okay, the file should not be in open state, it must be under closed state. So if you try to write the data into only one file continuously, the file will be always opened. So no other application can read the data from an opened file. That's not possible. So for that reason, we should have multiple files. Okay, we should have multiple files. And how frequent the files has to be created now? Files have to be created. No, why to have multiple files? The point here it is, if we have only one file, so if the file will be open always. Why? Because streaming data is going to enter into continuously, so the file will be always open. So we cannot perform processing. So no tool can perform processing of a file if it is under open. Okay, under open state. So under opening for writing the data into it. Okay. So in that, for this reason, we need to have multiple files. But how many multiple files we shall have? And how frequently? Whether based on the data or based on the interval or based on the size, that based on the count, based on the interval or based on the size. Count in the sense number of events, interval in the sense number of seconds, and size is nothing but the size of the data. Okay, so we can configure the files to be created. We can configure the files to be created. Okay, so depending upon the either number of events or number of seconds, that's interval, that's a number of seconds, are based on the size number of bytes. Okay, that's why here we have configured here. You can see here. Okay, role size, this talks about the size, and role count, there's a number of events, and role interval 10. So in this application, suppose if you say like this, let me copy this. Control C. And let me add this here. So agent 2 syncs 2 dot role size 0, role count 0, role interval 10. I will make this to 0. Role count I will make to some 10. Let us say no. So what is that we are making here? So a new file will be created for every 10 events. So every file will contain exactly 10 events. Got my point here? Just let me save this file. Just save this file. Nothing to do. Just save this file. No need to stop the application. Okay. Just save the file and enter the data. So every file should contain 10 records. Let us say it is true or not. So entering some random data here. So we have designed this application to create one file, you know, files in HDFS such a way that every file should contain exactly 10 events. Let us go to HDFS now and refresh this page. So we'll have all these files. Let's go back here. Just observe one in one file. How many events are there? You can count now here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. If I touch any file, the number of events will be exactly 10. Take any file. Okay, 10 events, 10 events, 10 events will be there. So this is, so here the size of the file may change. That depends upon the content of the file. The size of the records here, but the number of records will be exactly 10. So this is how we can configure, and this is one configuration. If you want, we can configure it to be a role size. Size in the sense, it will be in bytes. 1024. If I say 1024, that will be equal to 1 KB. The size of each file will be 1 KB, irrespective of the number of events. The size of the file will be, if this file reached 1 KB, a new file will be created. That's it. And if it is about the seconds here, interval, if we talk about 60 seconds, let us say 60. So for every 60 seconds, a new file will be created. Yeah, for every new seconds, a new file will be created. Irrespective of the amount of data that is there in the file, for every 60 seconds, a new file will be created. So this, with this, we can configure what has to be the file size, what has to, how many records or how many events must be returned to HDFS. Is it fine? Yeah, any questions in this place, Hina? Any questions in this? I think this is clear now. Yeah, please, please go on. What is the data if not being received for a certain time period? You know, files will not be created. That's very simple. Files will be created only when the data is received. Got it? You got my point, I think. Yeah. If the file is dead, then the data, then only file. What is the Spark couple? No, it will be, it will try to process the empty RDDs. That's it. RDDs will be empty. RDDs will be empty. That's it. No, processing will be done, but there's no data at all. We don't get anything. It will be empty file. That's it. And here, can we configure three, you know, these three properties at a time? Do you think an application can fulfill all these at a time? Will it be right to configure all these properties? No. So at a time, we can configure any one of these properties, either role size or count or interval. We cannot set all these. Okay. So if you want to enable only one property, set the remaining properties to zero. So if it is enabled, set to zero, and it is a meaning of it is a meaning that, what is that, these two properties, role size, role count, are disabled and role interval is enabled with 60 seconds. Got? Fine. This is how we will work this Flume application. This one. So by default, this interval is preferred. If you don't set anything, by default interval is preferred, and by the default value of interval is 30 seconds. The default value of interval is 30 seconds. If we don't say anything about this, let us say we did not tell anything about this. So what is going to happen? 30 seconds duration will be taken by default. 30 seconds duration. For every 30 seconds, if the data is coming continuously, for every 30 seconds, a new file gets created. Okay. Clear? Yeah, fine. Right, okay, we shall wind up for today. Tomorrow I will show you how to integrate this Flume with Spark, how Spark application will read the data from Flume, and at the same time we shall try to discuss about Kafka also, how to read the data from Kafka by the Spark. Okay, thank you. Thank you guys. Thanks for your time. Let's continue tomorrow.